Okay, it is Friday, which means it's officially time for another weekend reading vlog, and this is going to be another part in like my Unhinged series where I'm doing things a little bit weird and different in my reading vlogs. This weekend, we're going to read the entire Beautiful Creatures series because I need to decide if I want to keep these on my shelves or not, and I need to reread them to know if I want to keep them on my shelves or not. I borrowed all of the audiobooks as well for these from my library on Libby, so if I need to like stop reading and listen instead to do chores or whatever, I can, but they're pretty thick, so I think this could be like an undertaking. I don't think I'll have any real issues finishing it, but it's definitely gonna be like a hyper focus thing, and like I've got stuff going on this weekend, so it's gonna be a challenge. If you don't know, Beautiful Creatures came out post Twilight in like the paranormal romance YA vibe season, and it follows a kid from the south who ends up interacting with this group of like they're witches, basically. They have magic, but there's a lot of other elements of like the typical paranormal creatures involved as well. I remember really liking about this story that we were following like a mortal, mundane boy and a magical girl, which I felt like was a flip switch from what was typical of the kind of YA paranormal romances, but I'm excited to reread these. I hope that you guys come along and enjoy hearing my thoughts. I think I'm gonna update, it just kind of depends. I might do an end of the day update, or I might do like after I finish every book, or maybe spontaneous updates. I don't really know because I haven't read these in so long. I don't know how I'm gonna feel about them. This will be completely spoiler filled, so for whatever reason you are not interested in hearing spoilers for the series that is 11 years old at this point, oh my gosh, then don't watch this video. Otherwise, let's have some fun. It is very late. Unfortunately, I did not finish the first book today. I am about 400 pages in, so I'll have to finish this one up tomorrow. But I wanted to go ahead and update you guys since it's the end of the first day. I am having a good time with my reread. This is the book of the series that I've read the most. I think I've read this one twice previously, and I know I've seen the movie like twice, so I know this story pretty well. I didn't have it memorized like some of my other favorites from this time period, but I haven't really been surprised by anything that's happened, and it's been good just to get kind of back into the world. I enjoy the world and setting of this story because it's set in the South and I am from the South, and I don't know, I just enjoy getting to see the representation of like my culture on the page. However, books set in the South have either like really great representation of race relations or really awful representation, and I would put this in the almost awful category. There's a lot of conversation about the Civil War because it's a heavy plot point in like the magic system and the world building, but they don't treat it very well and appropriately. They kind of tend to lean towards it's the Southern perspective on the war. Like, we truly are taught in the South that it was the war of Northern aggression and that most of the soldiers in the war didn't really know what they were fighting for, and it was all over cotton and not slavery, which we know now that that's false. At least most people should. They don't address any of that here, which means it's true to the white understanding of the Civil War in the South. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it's okay to write a book without the perspective of others that are important when it comes to the Civil War. There are also characters of color in this book. It's written in a very like colorblind way. Like, people's skin tones aren't described, but based off of their names and their vernacular, like the way they speak, it's obvious that they're being... My phone died last night in the middle of updating you, and I did not feel like charging it and finishing last night, so I'm gonna finish my update right now. I don't remember where I was. I think I was talking about the Civil War and the representation of people of color in the book. It's not fantastic. It's all centered around the whiteness of the South, which I understand as a white person writing a book, especially in 2010 when there wasn't a push for diversity in books, that it may not have been a priority, but that still doesn't make it necessarily something that I want to recommend because the representation could be a whole lot better. Anyway, since I did not finish that book yesterday, I now have to finish that book today, read all of Beautiful Darkness, and start Beautiful Chaos if I'm going to finish all four of these today, which means I'm going to be doing nothing but reading today. So let's get started, because if I just keep pushing it off, I'm not gonna finish. I'm gonna put this one down and start the next one immediately, but I wanted to talk about the ending because there's some inconsistencies, but overall I think it was really good. I like the stakes of the story and how things kind of escalate towards the end. There's a lot of power dynamics and shifting all happening at once, which makes it exciting and entertaining. However, it's a little difficult to follow, like, spatially, like, what's happening and how things are changing. Also, the fact that there's, like, some death. I said spoilers. So, okay. People get hurt in the initial battle. Ethan goes and grabs the healer caster and their family, comes back to the battlefield. They heal everyone, and then Ethan goes to find Lena and gets stabbed in the stomach. But there's a healer on the battlefield, like literally right over there. She can heal. Now, they did put in some contingencies that she can only heal for a certain amount of time. She's just borrowing the powers. It's not gonna last very long. So maybe she could have tried to heal him. And then when that didn't work, then Lena could have got the book out and done her whole little switcheroo thing. But they didn't do a very good job of, like, saying what's happening and why it was necessary for her to use this big magical spell. Normally I hate resurrection tropes, but this one was done really, really well because it was set up early on in the book that this was going to be kind of a parallel, like, second chance opportunity for a Duquesne caster to save her Ethan Waite, you know? That was set up really early on, and so I think that kind of excuses the resurrection trope. And there was another sacrifice that kind of took the place of it, so I think it was done better than most YA resurrection tropes. Do I feel like at this point I'm going to keep this series on my shelf? Probably not. I am rereading it only because I have it. The only thing that I've really, like, enjoyed or that has stuck out more than other YA series at this point is the Southern setting, which I appreciate because of my own Southern roots, but I don't think it was done very well because they've completely, like, whitewashed everything, and they've approached the Civil War and the racism of people still upholding the Confederacy by just saying, oh, they're, like, stuck in time and it makes them super conservative and weird and I'm liberal, so I'm gonna think it's dumb, but I'm never actually gonna critically think about the racism of the fact that people are still celebrating battles that they won. Like, why would you want to celebrate that for any other reason than you wanted to win the war and keep your slaves? Like, you have to draw this out all the way. Also, the two characters of color in the story act as basically servants, housekeepers, or actually flashback housekeepers during plantation times. And they talk about plantations all the time. We go back in time and see plantations, but we don't hear anything about the slaves that were working those plantations right there. So it's just a very whitewashed version of the Civil War in the South, and hopefully we move away from that with the next several books and that might make it better. But as of right now, I don't know if I'm gonna keep it. I did have fun reading this book though. I am getting concerned about my ability to finish all of these. It's gonna mean some late nights, but that's okay. We're good with late nights. Thank you. I just made it to the halfway point of Booktube, so I wanted to give a quick update while I have my dogs outside. I don't like this one because they're breaking up, and I never like the stories where they break up because it's always heartbreaking. Like, every time, it's always just really, really sad, even though I know, like, things change in the future. But I think it's being done in a realistic way, if not, like, my favorite way. So in the first book, they had like a really actually healthy relationship as far as YA novels go, and Ethan was really encouraging, and Lena was really open and like sharing things when she felt that it was needed. But this book, it's the complete opposite. They're breaking up basically because of a miscommunication, but the reason for the miscommunication is actually kind of valid, but that doesn't mean it's not annoying to read. And it makes things like even worse. Like, if she could just tell Ethan the truth, like, he might be understanding, but also he might not be. So I kind of get it, but it's also annoying. The Civil War stuff has toned down a lot, and the world is expanding in a way that I always want out of sequels and things. So as far as that goes, it's going pretty well. I mean, I don't really have a lot more to say. I wish we had a perspective of Lena here, because I would like to know how she's actually feeling in this situation. Is she actually doing what she wants to be doing, or is she being influenced? Is she just going this way because she feels like it's the only way that makes sense with who she is, or is she just like kind of sad, so she's going dark? Because that doesn't necessarily make sense. I wish I could remember what happens in book 3 and book 4, because the whole Ethan being a wayward thing, I like don't understand why that ties in, because I just genuinely can't remember. But I guess I'll find out. Alright, it is just past midnight, Saturday night. I just finished the second book. I'm actually kind of bothered by how this one ended. I think it was like way too perfect. Everything went exactly as you would expect and didn't really set up much for book 3. I mean, there's a couple of things that are going to be fun to read about in book 3, but they're not like mysteries or any overhanging questions. It just kind of wrapped up too well, except for Liv. I feel like Liv got like the short end of the stick in this situation, and Ethan just like ruined her life and then said peace out. Again, I don't remember what happens in book 3, so maybe they're like actually friends, but if he's just like not talking to her after he ruined her career path and like basically got her to catch feelings and then ditched her for his girlfriend, that was a low blow. That was a very low blow. I also wish that Lena and Ethan had talked more about their experiences with their like third extra love interest in these books, in this book, just because, I don't know, that's what I feel like is normal in relationships. Once you get to that point and you've like basically cheated on your significant other, you should kind of talk about it to clear the air a little bit, and they didn't. They just kind of pretended like nothing happened. I do love that Lena made the choice to choose both. She chose both the light and the dark. But I feel like it's very similar to what happened at the end of book 1, and it makes me question if book 2 was even needed. I am going to start the third book tonight. I'm going to try to get about halfway through. I probably won't update you though, because it's going to be super late and I'm not going to be functioning. But tomorrow I'm going to finish the third book and read the whole fourth book, and then I will have completed the challenge of reading this whole series in one weekend. Alright, I'm going to keep reading and I'll update you later. just finished the third book, and I'm, like, severely disappointed. I thought this one was going to be, like, better. Halfway through the book, I was, like, really liking it. There's a lot of chaotic things happening. Relationships shifting and growing. Things coming together to form a coherent story. And then the end just went so far downhill. And I'm really kind of upset about it. Like I said, spoilers. If you don't want spoilers, whatever. Basically, Ethan dies again. Like, he died once in the first book, then was resurrected. Apparently, when that happened, his soul got split in two, even though the entirety of book two, there was no repercussions of him having half of a soul. So, I don't know if they came up with that for this third book or what, but somehow, in book two, when Lena chose both darkness and light, that broke the universe. That makes sense. I get it. It's cool. I don't understand why Ethan was the solution to putting the universe back together. That is what doesn't make sense to me. And they never really explained why that was what was needed. He had to make the sacrifice because he was the one who was two. But that's so dumb. Like, he's the one who was two, but the reason that he's the one who was two, it has nothing to do with the universe. It just simply has to do with the fact that his soul got split. And also, they didn't explain, like, why the one who was two needed to sacrifice himself to put it back together. Like, it's just not explained well enough. Like, I am a 25-year-old adult woman reading this YA series, and even I can't understand why what's happening is happening. So that's extremely annoying. But it is 8 o'clock on Sunday night, which means I'm going to be staying up till probably 3 or 4 a.m., maybe longer, trying to finish this last book. But we're going to get it done. And here is my sensory bag of honey. If you like sensory things, put some honey in a Ziploc bag because look at this. Ready? It's just really cool. I might update you at the halfway mark. I'm not really sure, but I'll see you in a bit. Alrighty, I finished the last book. I completed my challenge. I read the whole series in one weekend. And I am not going to say what I have decided. I'm going to record final series thought wrap up tomorrow and say what I have decided about the series. But I think if you've been like paying attention, you can probably tell where I'm going with this. But I did want to give some final thoughts about this book specifically. I thought the ending wrapped up just so uber duber sweet, and like, it wasn't all, like, I don't know, those kinds of endings make sense with stories like this where they're putting a bow on the end and like, it's meant to leave you with happy feel goods about the rest of the life with these characters. I'm fine with that. The whole big bad fight at the end with Angelus or whatever his name was super random and felt like almost like retconning of like, we're gonna say everything that happened in this series was because of this one guy because it makes a good story and not necessarily because that's what makes sense for the world. That's how I felt about this ending. And like, none of the mechanics are explained, like how the, I don't remember what they're called, but the people who like run the caster world and do the laws of the caster world and the keepers, like, suddenly they're the judgment holders for the souls of the afterlife. Like, how does that combination work? And why is it not ever explained more? It's just kind of shoehorned in there. They're like, oh yeah, this is the judge, jury, and executioner of the caster world. Oh yeah, they're also in the afterlife and tell you what happens with your soul, basically. I don't know. It was just a lot of convoluted mess. And I think that this whole book was bad. I didn't like this one. I thought that the way that they defeated Abraham was completely random and anticlimactic. Like, he was the big bad of the entire series. And he died so easily and quickly. And the conflict was, like, absolute ridiculousness. So, I now know why I didn't remember any of this series past book two. Because I blocked it out. Because it was bad. And I remember having questionable thoughts when I read these in high school, rereading them as an adult. I am fairly certain that there were a million ways that this story could have been told better. But I'm not going to get into all the details of the full series. That's my thoughts about this book. But at this point, I'm done. So I'm gonna go to bed. Thanks for coming along on this journey with me, and I'll see you in the morning. Okay, so it is Monday, and I'm wrapping up this weekend reading vlog where I read the entire Beautiful Creatures series in one weekend. to see if I wanted to keep it or not. And the consensus is officially no, I am not going to be keeping these books. And now I would like to tell you why. So for starters, these aren't bad books. I would classify them as average. In some cases, they go above average. In some cases, they go below average. Some things that I love about this series are the vibes. They're immaculate. If you want dark, twisty, just look at these covers. YA fantasy set in like Southern Gothic Georgia. I mean, you cannot get anything more aesthetically pleasing and atmospheric what you want if you're looking for that than these books. They have the vibes. It's all there. It's fantastic. Another thing I really like is the relationships between the characters. I don't necessarily love the characters themselves, but I love the relationships and the way they interact with each other. Ethan and Alma and Ethan and Lena and Lena and Macon and Ethan and Link and Link and Ridley and Ridley and Lena, just the way they all interact between each other is a very fun time. The characters themselves can fluctuate between very unique as well as very stock and stereotypical, but that's okay. Like, that's just part of writing sometimes, especially within the YA genre. I really like the world and the magic system that's built on a basic level. One of my biggest concerns is when it comes to the consistency of the world as well as the explanations for why things happen within the magic system. I'm not talking explicit explanations, like literally telling you why something happened, but the logical explanations of things happening and trying to draw connections and lines between things just gets very convoluted and confusing, and it's completely inconsistent throughout the books. Like I said, I would call this like better than average in some cases and worse than average in others, so a star rating would be 3-star series. But the reason I'm specifically not keeping this book is because I like my shelves to be a reflection of who I am as a reader, and this is no longer a reflection of me as a reader. Maybe high school Rachel, this was me, but now as a 25-year-old adult woman, I don't think that this series reflects who I am as a reader. Some of the reasons that's the case is YA in particular. I am not a huge YA reader. I am only going to keep YA books if they absolutely blow me out of the water or if I feel like there are things that I want to share with other people possibly in the future. I don't necessarily want to share these books with anyone. If you've read them, if you're planning to read them, that's fine, that's on you. But as far as like a good representation of the genre, I don't think this is the best of the best. I'm specifically bothered by the portrayal of the Civil War in the South. I mean, it's very true to the white experience of the South, but it completely neglects the experience of other people of color, specifically Black people, when it comes to how the South reveres the Civil War. There are ways to confront those issues without just kind of giving it a pass, and I feel like these authors gave it a pass. The main character and his family are liberal, and they think it's stupid how their town reenacts Civil War battles, but there's never any like critical thought or any confrontation when it comes to the fact that, hey, you're revering a war that literally fought to keep people enslaved. I mean, we go back in time to plantations, and we never talk about the fact that those plantations were run by slaves. And we're talking about how the Union Army came through and burned plantations, and they talk about it as if it's like this sad and tragic thing. Like, our poor plantation homes got burned to the ground. Like, yeah, they deserve to be burned to the ground. You were keeping people as slaves, as property. Okay, little bit of a soapbox that's not needed, but that is probably my biggest issue with the book. With the books. I keep saying the book, but I mean the series. My other issue had to do with the endings of every book. I think every book had a poor, weak ending. I think that the like plots of what was happening were interesting and entertaining, but resolving all of the convolutedness into a concise, clear, we understand what happened ending did not happen at any point. Also, the last book just felt like completely something separate and not even connected to the whole story at large. I'd say my favorite book was probably the third one. I had the most fun with it, and the chaotic nature of things that were happening and the stakes of people losing their powers and Abraham taking over the world, like there were high stakes. But then it just ended with Ethan killing himself for no reason. Like, it didn't explain why he was the one that had to die at all. And the fourth book was supposed to act as some kind of closure to that and tell us why that specifically happened, and it didn't. It just said this one guy was changing history and fate by writing in the book, but they didn't explain why or how, and they didn't explain like the mechanics of the fact that this book controls fate. I'm rambling. it's very convoluted. I think if you're someone that doesn't like to think critically about what they read and you're just in it for the vibes and the fun time, absolutely, you will love these books. If you're going to even have an ounce of criticism, or you're going to even be thinking deeply about social justice issues, race relations, plotting, consistency, tropes, there's lots of tropes in here, and they're not done really well. Like, tropes are not a bad thing if you can do them in a way that's not cliche and that is unique, but that did not happen here for any of these tropes, hardly at all. I feel like I'm kind of bashing these books, but that's not my intention at all. My goal is purely to say I read these books in a weekend, because otherwise I probably wouldn't have gotten through the reread. I probably would have stopped if I didn't have a challenge to set myself for. And I'm not going to keep them, because although I love the vibes and the Southern Gothic setting and how that relates to me as a person born and raised in the South, there's a lot lacking and a lot that could be improved upon and a lot of issues that just make it a series that I don't want to represent myself in my shelves. That is the video. Thank you so much for watching this with me, for sticking around to the end, for going on this journey with me. I hope if you love this series that you did not take anything too personally about what I said. These are just my subjective opinions and how I feel about the book series in general. I'd love to know your thoughts down below, if you love the series or hate the series, or if you've read it or not read it. Just tell me down in the comments. Also, if you have a series on your shelf that you're debating keeping, maybe you should try out this weekend reading vlog challenge and let me know how it goes. If you like the way I talk about books and the things that I read, don't forget to subscribe. I will see you all in the next video. Ba-do-boo, backstabber.